I'm Dan Russell, and I'm happy to have a very distinguished panel here to speak about the commercial and economic part of U.S. relations. And I'd like to commend Angela and Andy for including this on the program. This is not a group we usually do this with, and I think it's certainly an important part of the relationship that perhaps doesn't get as much attention in this town as it deserves. And I think we want to try to cover a couple of questions today. First, about the state of the Russian economy, but I think even more importantly are to get some firsthand views from businessmen who've been very, very involved in Russia for the last couple of decades. And then to talk a little bit about the role of the private sector and what dialogue can do in terms of buttressing the relations. I'll introduce everybody individually. You've got all their bios as we start with the speakers. But I think I'd like to make a few comments at the beginning to sort of frame the discussion, particularly on Russia's economy. And I'd like to start with five basic points here. And all of these are fairly obvious, I think, but I think they're worth repeating. First, Russia's economy has adjusted to the twin shocks of lower oil prices and sanctions better than most observers expected. Real GDP contracted about 3% in 2015 with a sharp drop in national income and consumer demand. But it easily could have been worse. And Russia's move to a flexible exchange rate, I think, deserves much of the credit for buffering the shock. Second, sanctions, since we're in Washington, that's always a part of the discussion. I think the impact of sanctions were significant, particularly the sectoral sanctions that limited access to foreign capital. But let's be clear. That the oil price collapse was the main driver in Russia's recession. And to put it another way, sanctions reinforced the impact of the decline in oil prices. And by the way, Russia's own counter-sanctions banning imported foodstuffs from the European Union, the United States, and other countries drove up food prices by 15 or 20%. Now, all that said, I think it's important to keep in mind that the easing of sanctions would have a limited effect on economic recovery. And in terms of metrics, I'd turn to the World Bank. The World Bank did an alternative economic forecast scenario for 2017 with sanctions lifted. And that alternative scenario posits a GDP gain of less than 1% this year, basically from the expected rise in investor and consumer confidence, but no appreciable benefit from a sanctions lift for 2018 and beyond. And that's what brings me to my third point. Russia's economic growth model was predate the 2014 oil price collapse and imposition of sanctions. Russia's economic performance never fully recovered from the last global financial crisis, and growth has been dropping steadily since 2011. So if we go back to 2013 and we look at the numbers, you'll find that growth had dropped to 1.3% despite the fact that the average price of oil was $108 a barrel. So fourth is Russia's recovery is going to be slow. The recession appears to have bottomed out, and we're going to see very modest growth this year, probably in the 1 to 1.5% range. But the Russian leadership's goal of 4+% economic growth in the near term is simply unrealistic. And which brings me to my last and fifth point on the economy, and probably most importantly, that the elephant in the room remains Russia's lack of comprehensive structural reform and the unlikelihood of such reforms before the 2018 presidential election. At its core, a structural reform program would reduce the state's role in the economy and increase competition. Russians know exactly what to be done. We've all seen plenty of Russian plans for reform throughout the Putin years. We're going to see another one shortly when former Deputy Prime Minister Alexei Kudrin rolls his out later this spring. But I think the important point here is that without structural reform, at least in my opinion, The bottom line is that growth forecasts above 2% in the medium term seem unachievable. And with that, I'd like to turn to our first discussant here on the panel, who is Fyodor Voitilovsky. He's a rising star in Russian academia. He's the head of the political section at the Center for North American Studies at IMEIMO, that is the Institute of World Economy and International Relations. He also teaches at MGIMO, the other alphabet soup, very important academic institution, Moscow State Institute of International Relations. Fyodor is probably best known as one of the co-authors of IMEIMO's Strategic Global Forecast 2030 and its annual forecasts on Russia and the world economic and foreign policy. With that, Fyodor, over to you.
Thank you very much, Dan. I'm very grateful to Georgetown University for inviting me. And I'm really puzzled by Angela and Andrew, who have asked to speak about economic issues, because I'm a political scientist. It's much easier for me to talk about INF Treaty or STAR Treaty or everything like that. But this time, especially in this company, brilliant company of professionals from economy, it's a hard task for me, but I'll try to do my best. So I want to focus on historic perspective and on the development of economic ties, not only between modern Russia and the United States, but I want to try to concentrate attention on a longer term period. Because to my mind, the logic of sanctions, the logic of current economic attitude towards Russia in the United States nowadays reminds a lot from the period of Cold War era, and reminds a lot from attitudes and politics different administrations used against Soviet Union, principally different country, principally different, and principally different economy in the Cold War era period. What is different? Different ideological motivation of Soviet Union, different social, economic, and political system. At least market economy was not the basement of Soviet economy. It was absolutely different economy. But at the same time, the United States are using principles of sanctions and punishment for inappropriate behavior towards one of principal economies or major economies of this world, but very significant regional economy with global ties, and we're highly interdependent with other countries, including American partners and allies, including EU and NATO members. What is giving background for such assumption for me? First of all, from the beginning, Soviet-American economic relations in terms of trade, investment, were developing in a very different manner if we compare it to relations with modern Russia. But the politics always were prevailing over economic motivation. And this logic is continuing to develop. What gives me such background? First of all, from the beginning, when the United States didn't have official diplomatic relations with the Soviet Union, unofficially economic ties developed. And in 1924, the Amtorg company, cooperative company for developing trade between Soviet Union and the United States, developed. But it worked only for six years, because in 1929 and then in 1930, the United States applied first sanctions against trade with Soviet Union. They even reached to embargo and had very negative influence not only on economic ties between two countries, but also on political relations. Only in 1937, relations restored, and two countries signed an agreement on trade relations. And this was the beginning of the positive period, first positive period in official Soviet and American economic ties. It lasted until 1947. And, you know, this period and the wave of positive relations, each time, you know, it changed with very negative trend in mutual trade, mainly trade and economic ties, mainly caused not by economic reasons, but mainly by political. The paradox is that this logic continues. After the Second World War, when the United States helped a lot to the Soviet Union with Lend-Lease program and supported strongly, you know, Soviet economy with not only military stuff, but also raw materials, technologies, and different goods. In 1947, Department of Commerce of the United States denounced this trade agreement, and you know, this period, which lasted for more than 25 years, was one of the hardest periods in Soviet American trade. The Commission on Export Control has been established. Sanctions were applied. Sanctions, different kinds of sanctions on technology sector, on trade, and only in 1972, in the developing under the logic of détente, relations started to develop in a normal way, and you know, the agreement between two countries has been prepared, but it changed soon with opposite logic of sanctions and pressure because of Jewish migration from the Soviet Union and prohibitions which Soviet government used, and you, all of you know Jackson-Vanik and its consequences. Then there was a very long-term negative period which lasted during during Carter administration and Reagan administration. But it has changed with another positive period which started in 1987 and lasted, to my mind, till 1993 or something like that. The change, political change in Russia, has been supported strongly with economic, you know, romance with the United States. Very short period and very small in terms of figures, in terms of figures of real trade and investment, but very significant for developing of principles of market economy in Russia and developing of political, you know, political system of Russia and its economic background. American advisors played a special role in the development of Russian economic system. First, American enterprise, and I believe some of people who came there in 1990s are sitting here. They started a lot of new beginnings in Soviet Union and in Russia. And, you know, this positive period lasted for some time. But because of political risks in, you know, unstable Russian political system, relations and economic relations were decreasing. The next positive period, it was again motivated by political motive, by political, you know, decisions and official course. And in 2001, after Russia supported the United States after 9/11 and gave support in Afghanistan and relations between two presidents developed positively, another period of development of trade and investment and the common interest towards each other has started. It decreased with, degradation of political attitudes and political relations on high official level and on military political level. But with policy of reset in 2009, another new positive wave has started, another positive cycle in Russian-American economic relations. And it lasted until the Ukrainian crisis, 2013. What was main features of this period? First, exponential growth of trade, because from a very tiny figures, it mounted to figures which has become which have become significant for Russian economy. In 2011, it amounted to 42 billions of dollars, which is not significant figure in terms of American foreign trade, but it was significant for Russian foreign trade, and the United States has become 10th trade partner for modern Russia. In 2013, the figure was approximately the same, 41.2 billions of dollars, and the figure of foreign direct investments in American foreign direct investments in Russia was about 10 billions of dollars, which is also significant for Russian economy. Maybe it's absolutely not significant figure for American flows of foreign direct investments, but for Russia again it was significant. What has happened after the Ukrainian crisis? Now we have only 20 billions of dollars in our trade turnover. Foreign direct investments, American foreign direct investments in Russia decreased to less than 3 billions of dollars. Russian foreign direct investments in the United States are approximately the same, but it is absolutely incomparable to amounts of trade, for example, the United States are having with China, for obvious reasons, and absolutely incomparable to the amounts of trade that Russia used to have before crisis with European Union. It was approximately about 400 billions of dollars, and with China, all of you know that the United States are having 600 billions of dollars in trade turnover, and with China, from Deng Xiaoping's policy of openness and reforms, American policy, even including sanctions after Tiananmen, even including sanctions after Taiwan crisis in 1996, was always based on economic rational motivation and not on political logic. With Russia, the situation was opposite from the beginning, and the paradox is it developed in opposite the direction, not only during Cold War period, but after it. And it was highly dependent on political decisions and political attitudes. So we are facing the problem when the principal feature of this problem is that economic background did not become a buffer for normal relations when political situation is getting into crisis. That's it.
Thank you very much, Fyodor, for that historic perspective on sanctions. I just add a note. We all see the very low numbers in terms of foreign direct investment and trade turnover, and certainly there's been a decline. But I think one thing many of us who've worked on this for years have been stymied by those numbers, because with the development of the global economy and global firms, those numbers are not very representative of of actual trade and investment. And in fact, Ernst & Young took a crack at this before the crisis to look backwards at 2012 at who are the biggest investors in Russia. And if you look in FDI on the official Russian government site, you'll see Bahamas, Cyprus, not necessarily big players.
Sure.
But Ernst & Young looked at the metrics of job creation and infrastructure creation. And the United States was roughly about a quarter of foreign investment in Russia. And the European Union together was about 60%. So if you took the United States, the European Union, and Japan, you got to around 95% of foreign investment. And I think that's fairly representative. When we go to the St. Petersburg International Forum, for instance, and you look at CEOs who are interested in being there and participating, I think, again, you see more representative, where about three quarters of them are from Europe and about a quarter of them are from the United States. but with that, we'd like to turn to the business part of our panel here. And I think, building on what Fyodor said, because this is this conference is about 25 years of U.S.-Russia relations, it's important to look backward as well as to look forward. And I will tell you that of the four friends sitting here, I think we were all in Russia in the early 1990s and well into the 2000s. So it's interesting to see, I think, what attracted all of you to invest and do business in Russia in the first place, and how you navigated previous crises, because we certainly had a crisis in 98, and in 2008, you can argue this one is different with the political overlay, but there's some lessons to be learned there. And also, how you see certainly the short and long term. And we're going to start with Mike Calvi. Mike is the founder and senior partner of Baring Private Equity International and Baring Vostok Capital Partners. Mike founded Baring in 1994, and he's been involved in nearly all the investments of both funds since their inception. He previously worked at the European Bank for Reconstruction and Development, and Solomon Brothers as well, in both cases looking at energy investments in Eastern Europe and Russia. With that, Mike.
Thanks, Dan. So I got involved investing in Russia differently from many of the other people. I didn't study Russian in university. I don't have Russian ethnic roots or anything else. I, you know, grew up in the Midwest and went to work for a bank in New York on oil and gas projects, and was moving to their London office when my boss joined the EBRD, Ron Freeman, as their chief investment officer. So he brought me to the EBRD. It was in August of 1991, the month when the coup happened. Interesting time. I thought briefly that I made a really stupid career move, but you know, then with Yeltsin and all the changes that happened, it turned out to be a brilliant time. But you know, why I specifically decided to move to Russia, I remember meeting Bob Strauss, you know, former U.S. ambassador in the late Soviet period, and he was talking to a group of young people like me. And he said, "If I was a young man and I had just $10,000 to my name, I'd move to Russia and bet it all on Russia. But if I was an old man and I had $10 million, I would still only bet $10,000 on Russia." but I, you know, I was young and had only about $10,000, so it seemed like the right move. And I moved to Moscow in 1994, helped to raise one of the first investment funds, you know, together with some of the other people that are up here now. And you know, 23 years later, still actively investing in Russia. Baring Vostok has invested over that time more than $3 billion into Russian companies, about 75 Russian companies, including many that became, you know, famous and leading companies in their sectors, like Vimpelcom, one of the leading mobile phone operators, Yandex, which is the like the Google of Russia, European Medical Center, Avito, 1C, STS television channel, and many others. You know, I guess I'll just make sort of two groups of comments. One is about what's the outlook now for the economy and business, and then what role has business played, or does business play, you know, foreign business in the overall relationship. So I'm not going to repeat the comments which Dan made, all of which I agree. In comparison with the crises in 1998 and 2008, which we saw, which were very steep crises followed by a V-shaped recovery, this time, you know, the downturn has been less steep, and the expectation from everyone is that the recovery will also be less pronounced. So people don't expect very fast economic growth coming out of this. But it's still a good environment, I think, to invest, because economic statistics don't tell the whole story. And I'll give three examples. This is something similar to what Vladimir Mao said last night. But there's a secular change that's happening in economies around the world that's driven by the internet and changes in customer behavior. And the same things that are happening everywhere in the world are happening also in Russia. So we see really transformative businesses growing very fast, you know, in, you know, online marketplaces, e-commerce, and even the way businesses find customers or suppliers and transact. And some of these things actually have a negative effect on the economy, like Vladimir said last night. But they create outstanding businesses that are taking advantage of the opportunity, and they're good for the economy overall. So we own 32 businesses now. And the average growth rate in revenues, the average growth rate in revenues in our portfolio last year was more than 30% in ruble terms. So really, you know, opportunities to invest in significant size companies that are growing as fast or faster as their peers anywhere else in the world. So that's one thing. The second thing is that for the first time in the 23 years when I've been involved in Russia, inflation is coming down towards a low single digit number. And interest rates are also coming down significantly. The central bank rate is actually much higher than the rate at which banks borrow or take money from customers in deposits and pay them deposit interest rates. So for the, you know, Russia has been an outlier if you compare it to similar sized emerging markets like India or Brazil. It doesn't have any long-term domestic institutional capital. There were no mortgages, there was no life insurance market, there was no domestic asset management. And the main reason was that if you could get 10% interest rate in rubles putting your money in a bank guaranteed by the Russian government, why would you take any risk to invest in shares or something else like that? But when the interest rate you get is only 6% and inflation is 4% or something like that, and the trends are they're both going down, people start to look elsewhere to make higher returns. So this is really a game changer. We see a number of industries that are huge in other parts of the world that are really at an infancy still in Russia, and which over the next 10 years have potential for huge growth. So that presents also an interesting, I think, investment opportunity. And the last thing is about, you know, foreign direct investment and what's changed as a result of the sanctions. So obviously, you know, sanctions have caused have been part of the reason why foreign direct investment in Russia fell very sharply compared to, say, 2012 or 13. But I think there's also a change in the sourcing of new foreign direct investment. I don't agree with what Dan said about, I mean, historically, obviously, foreign direct investment in Russia was dominated by European, North American strategic investors. Today, you see, you know, more and more Chinese, and also you see a lot of interest from, you know, from Arab countries in the Middle East. But the type of foreign direct investment which they can do is different. It's different in the industries that they comprise. So, in the some of the biggest investors from the U.S. were, you know, global brands in consumer goods manufacturing or retail, or, you know, some of the world's biggest natural resources companies. And I think what you see, you know, that you don't see such a big activity from the Chinese companies. They don't have global consumer brands and retailers outside of the internet. So you see the big internet players from China. Alibaba is the number one e-commerce company in Russia today. JD.com, various others, they're growing very fast. But outside of the internet, you know, you see it more in manufacturing, infrastructure, natural resources, which were areas which were not high on the priority list from, you know, U.S. or European strategic investors. And that from the Middle East, they're mostly looking to invest in big Russian companies. So it's more like portfolio investment rather than strategic investment. But I think my sense is that, you know, the Chinese especially are very slow to ramp up. They're signing lots of protocols to invest, but not actually investing a lot of cash. But it's starting to build momentum, and it's going to become, you know, much bigger over time. So about the role of business. So obviously the companies that we've invested in have helped to transform Russia. It's made it, you know, much more open and modern and transparent economy, and they've changed their customers' lives by offering better quality products or services. But besides that, I think that the role we've played has also, you know, made Russia better, and it's good for U.S.-Russia relations as well. When we first started investing in the 1990s, money in companies was often made around the company but not inside the company. You know, it was by having your own trading relationships or something else like that. People were undermining companies as a way to make money because nobody really believed in making money from the shares. And you know, we've really helped to change that. We and, you know, other foreign investors like us have helped to change that with a number of very high-profile success stories that have, you know, in their turn inspired lots of other entrepreneurs or other people. And seeing the power of keeping the money inside the company being transparent about the profits, establishing the right kind of governance where management is paid, you know, big money for big results, but it's all done transparently, as opposed to, you know, non-transparency and where people are not paid, they're encouraged to look for money elsewhere. So the right sort of corporate governance practices that work everywhere else in the world has helped to make the economy, you know, more transparent. And I guess the other thing that we always do is when, you know, we try to benchmark our companies against their best peers everywhere else in the world. And so we, you know, we and other people like us have helped Russian companies develop a culture where they're constantly looking around the world for who's doing things better. And what, you know, what best ideas can be copied. And Russians are great at this. We find when the incentives are right, you know, Russian managers and entrepreneurs are brilliant at moving very quickly, maybe even better than most other countries, especially, you know, adapting to or responding to problems or changes. And that sort of culture kind of also, I think, is like a ripple effect that, you know, that has been adopted across most of the successful companies in Russia. And that's, you know, foreign investors like us have really been, have really played an instrumental role, I think, in seeing that happen. And, I, you know, it's obviously a tragedy to all of us, you know, watching the failure of U.S.-Russia relations now. And, it, you know, I think U.S. policy is long overdue for a critical reassessment and some changes. And it's really extremely sad watching what's happening now in Washington, which probably, you know, probably is going to make it impossible for any sort of a fair and objective reassessment to take place. And so, you know, when we look at it, you know, we sort of assume that sadly the situation, you know, the sanctions will probably remain in place for a very long time. And you have to assume if you're going to make money investing in a Russian company, you assume that you're buying it now at a discount. You have to assume that you'll be selling it also at a discount. And the only way you're going to really make money is through fundamental growth of the company. And thankfully, there's a lot of companies that are growing very fast, you know, with unique businesses, great management teams, and you can make excellent returns compared to many other places just from that fundamental growth. But I think that a sort of, you know, a cold and sober assessment of the situation doesn't give any encouragement about what should be taking place on the political side. And so, you know, we're pretty pessimistic about that.
Thank you, Mike. next up, we've got Drew Guff, who is the managing director and a founding partner of Sigur Guff, which is a private equity investment firm. In the 1990s, Drew formed a Russian Partners Company, one of the earliest private equity funds in post-communist Russia. And today, Russia Partners actively manages a portfolio not only in Russia, but in other former Soviet republics.
Thanks, Dan. I'm Drew Guff, and Mike Calvi always tells the story of when I used to call him sometimes on deals in Russia, his wife would answer the phone, and I would say, "Hi, this is Drew Guff calling from Mike. Is Mike there?" And she would turn to Mike and say, "Mike, Gospodin Drew Guff is calling you." So I go by Drew Guff sometimes in the familia Drew Guff. This really brings, I have to say, you know, I'm kind of struck by a sense of nostalgia up here because, first of all, it's very rare that the four of us get together, at least the three of us, and I got to know Peter later, were the kind of three crazy Americans who went over to Russia in the late 80s, early 90s, really on this sense of adventure. The same country that brought you communism was the same country that was pulling it down and rebuilding, remodeling what was a failing economy. And the amount of energy and passion and dynamism that it took to do that is breathtaking. You rarely see, I'm an investor who invests across all the emerging markets in private equity, and you rarely see that amount of forward momentum and energy at any given time. And seeing that, I know, was something that was really attractive to me, and I'm sure as well as for Mike and Charlie. So we really could write the book, I think, of kind of the inside story of you know, the 25 years of post-communist history. Whether or not we would have the bad judgment to ever write that book is another question. But it would be extremely entertaining because I've got the goods on them, and they've got the goods on me, and we've got the goods on lots of other people. But Mike is right. If you look at how we're all long-term investors, and it's very different from the hedge fund world. The hedge fund world, people buy stocks. You can do it from London or New York behind the safety of your computer screen, and your money is hot. It can flow in, and in a crisis, it can flow back out. What's rare about this group, and we rarely assemble on a panel, which is giving me this intense sense of nostalgia here, is that private equity money is very long term. Tends to be shorter term in the States because there's more liquidity in investments, capital markets work better. But in Russia, it's quite long-term investments. And a lot of the household names of companies that provide services and products that has changed the life of everyday ordinary Russians have come from the, see, that's how exciting it is. People are throwing chairs already. It's I'd say it's probably about $4 billion that this group has put to work in Russia. If actually, Mike, if you're three, it's about $5 billion that this group has put to work. And some of those companies are really well known. Mike and Charlie have been in Yandex, which everybody uses. We started the TV channel MTV Russia, Music Television Russia. It was revolutionary at the time. We owned it together with Viacom. STS was one of Mike's investments. If you want to have your blood tested and you go to medical diagnostics, In Vitra is one of our companies. Mati Ditya Medical Centers, Radio Sim, Nasa Michal Mach, all those companies that are kind of household names were things that grew up with the investment and backing of these crazy foreign investors who raised these private equity funds. And for 20 years, the returns on those funds had been really excellent. If we benchmark private equity returns around the world, and up until the Ukraine crisis, 2014, the returns on those private investments were really excellent. They were always top quartile. And investors really knew who to go to make those investments. I would describe where we are today as kind of a pause. There's a break in the action. Interest in Russia right now, I would say, is neutral or muted, partly because of the politics. But also because of another phenomenon that we see going on in Brazil. If you were to look at the macro picture of Russia and Brazil, and you took the names off, and you just looked at GDP growth, you looked at reliance of the economy on exports, if you looked at worker productivity, if you looked at the budget is one area which differs greatly, but in foreign trade, foreign investment, capital flows, stock market trends, and you took the names off, it really would be a kind of Coke and Pepsi taste test. Brazil looks a lot like Russia and vice versa right now. And in that sense, those that invested before 2014, those that invested before the fall in the price of oil, those that invested before the commodity crisis, have seen a depreciation of the value of their investments. And we're now at a new resetting level. I think we've got a fairly stable ruble again. We've got a fairly stable real in Brazil. And the two economies are very much dependent on the makeup of the economy that is largely commodity dependent. So same goes for Canada, same goes for Australia. We're seeing a kind of reset on the investment landscape. But I think there will be a hangover for some time regarding attracting new investment to Russia. I can't disagree with any aspect of what Dan said in summarizing where the Russian economy is. I think, you know, unless there is meaningful structural economic reform, Russia can't get to the growth rates it needs now to really attract large capital flows. I do think, in terms of the business relationship between the U.S. and Russia, previous to this administration, CEOs were discouraged from going to Russia, investing in Russia, going to St. Petersburg for the International Economic Forum. That's gone. And so I think you'll start to see those that can do business there and those that want to do business there will feel like the shackles are off. But I think that the larger picture, how investable is Russia right now? Is it doing the things that it needs to do to attract investors back, particularly foreign investors back? I think we're not quite there yet. And I don't think we'll see anything happen until after the 2018 election. But so I would highlight one area where I think Russia has had a real leading edge. And as we go back and look at our portfolio, Mike's portfolio, Charlie's portfolio, and we look at what have been the real successes in the past 5 or 10 years, it's true not just for Russia, it's true for China, it's true for India. If you look at the greatest successes, the biggest growth rates, they were businesses that didn't exist before at all. It's not a converted juice plant, it's not a cement factory, it's not a bank. It's in the area where people have really made the transition to the digital economy. So how people search for things, how people find things, how people order things, how they pay for things, how they have them delivered, all of that is a secular change that's changing life in the developed markets and also in the developing economies. And if you look at the returns from the Yandexes or the EPAMs or the or Alibaba for that matter, the biggest returns in emerging markets have come from technology and the shift to the digital economy. Today, you'll find tremendous numbers of Chinese in Silicon Valley, tremendous numbers of Indians, and more Russians and Eastern Europeans and Ukrainians and Belarusians in Silicon Valley. And they're now grafting onto kind of the pyramid of commercialization of developed economy businesses. Partly because they see greater opportunities there, but they also occupy an interesting zone that is a interesting buffer area, and we'll continue to see, I think, the best, brightest spots coming out of Russia for the next 5 years and former Soviet Union will be these companies that really are using human capital for their growth and not being dependent on the commodity sector, not being dependent on natural resources. So I think human resources will continue to be the story, some of which is leaving permanently, some of which is occupying this kind of global citizen status, which is investable and are creating some really good high-level, well-paying jobs in Russia and former Soviet Union.
So, thanks. Thank you, Drew. Now we'll shift gears a little bit and go to Peter O'Brien. And Peter is on the board of directors of TMK. And for those of you who don't know TMK is a one of the largest Russian private sector companies with international reach. It's one of the leading global manufacturers of steel pipe for the oil and gas industry, and it operates production facilities not only in Russia, but in the United States, Canada, Romania, Oman, Kazakhstan. And it also has research and design development centers in Russia and in the United States. So TMK came to the United States as a foreign investor, much like companies go to Russia. Now, Peter, like everybody else up here, has lots of experience in Russia. He's the chairman of the board of TransfinM, which is a Russian railroad and transportation leasing company. Earlier in his career, he was vice president of Troika Dialogue Investment Bank, which is talking about Drew's nostalgia. We all remember Troika Dialogue from the 90s. And he went on to hold other positions, including executive director of Morgan Stanley in Russia and vice president for finance and investments of Rosneft. Pete?
Thanks, Dan. So to start with your first point, how did I sort of get started and interested in Russia? I was fortunate enough to have a phenomenal language teacher in high school from junior year of high school that taught Russian language. And then I continued it in university. And shortly after university, I was a junior appointee to the Treasury Department under Secretary Benson, and was asked to do a visit with the administration team in February 93 to Vancouver. Some of you might remember the first summit between Yeltsin and Clinton in Vancouver. And I was asked to help organize a few press events with my Russian colleagues, and I realized that my Russian was really bad. So I thought it had been really good after 6 years of studying it, but I realized it was really bad. So that was, together with my Irish guilt complex, that was the real motivation for me to move to Moscow, which in the end I did full-time in 1995 and ended up working. My first real job there was for Troika Dialogue, as Dan mentioned, which was a great, young, small investment bank with a few other expats, but largely Russians, at a very early stage in the development of the Russian capital markets. Then, after the crisis in 98, an important point, I also met my wife there in 1995. We were married there in 1998. We now have two kids. We're back living in the States now as our kids finish up high school. But after leaving in 98 for a little while, I came back to Russia for Morgan Stanley, and then ended up moving to Rosneft in 2006 to help do their IPO. We raised $11 billion of equity at a very high valuation. In 2006, and then a year later, this might shock you guys if you've forgotten, Drew, but we did a $22 billion bridge financing deal at 25 basis points over LIBOR.
Wow.
So price of money has obviously moved quite a bit for Russian creditors, irrespective of sanctions. Couple points. I think one of the things I think many of us have always said in living and trying to work and help advance the economy in Russia is, wouldn't it be great to have a long period of low oil prices? Wouldn't that actually force some of the changes that are probably necessary? Well, we have had that now for some time, and I think we're all hopeful that whether it's that or the 2018 election and the lack of growth recently and maybe the need to address some domestic issues, we're all hopeful that these issues will come together over the next year or two and help continue to improve the economy in Russia and make it more amenable to foreign investment. On the oil sector, just a couple thoughts. I had a recent discussion with a senior executive at a supermajor and was asking about their Russian business, which he had been part of since the early 90s. And this gentleman always talked about how much potential Russia had and how many phenomenal geologists there were and engineers, and they were really, really very bullish about, even if it was very long term, the potential for their business in Russia. But he said to me a couple weeks ago, he said, you know, we've shut our office. We had one very talented staff member we had to let go because we just couldn't get it through the business plan this year. And in the end, at these oil prices, which we think we'll be at for some time, we've got a lot more to do in North America. And we've all lived the last 25 years looking at big headline deals in Russia, and a lot of them have been oil sector or financing for the oil space, and we probably all benefit from the budgets that those large companies have and the attention they can draw on the media, et cetera, when things are going well. But they're probably not going to be there for quite a while, and that's not because of sanctions. It's because economically it's just not interesting, whether it's the oil price or just maybe some of the risks in Russia. Second sector I'd like to talk briefly about is the financial sector. When I joined Morgan Stanley in 2000, Russia was less than a $3 or $4 million business for Morgan Stanley globally. And that's just on the investment banking side. Moved there from London in 2002, we were up to $5 million. When I left for Rosneft, we were at almost $150 million, and that's investment banking. So that's advisory and underwriting revenue. It's very high margin. And Russia was actually the third most profitable in amount of millions of dollars franchise of Morgan Stanley in all of Europe. So it was only behind Germany and the UK in 2006. Unfortunately, it declined substantially after 2007, obviously with the 08 oil crisis and oil price collapse, Lehman Brothers, Georgia, Ukraine, et cetera. But we do see some green shoots. I still talk to my colleagues there and at other investment banks. And just in the past 15 months, we've seen 14 equity issues out of the Russian capital markets, several MIPOs, largely much more domestic driven now than European and US investors, but some US investors starting to dip their toes back in. But the financial sector and competitive space in Moscow has certainly become much more driven by Sberbank and VTB and Otkritie than previously would have been UFG, Deutsche, Credit Suisse, Morgan Stanley, JP Morgan, et cetera, Renaissance. The last thing I'd like to touch on is just the people. And I think my experience on a few corporate boards now in Russia, I think is fairly representative of business anywhere, whether Russia or the United States or anywhere. All these companies are different. And there are a lot of good people, and there are some less good people. And I think if you look at doing business in Russia or joining a board or making an investment in Russia, it's first and foremost about finding the people that you can spend time with and sincerely feel that you can trust and that your interests are aligned. And I have to say that over my 25 years or so of being there, that's getting a lot easier to do than it would have been in the 1990s, to actually figure out who's sitting across the table from you, you know, whether they've been educated in the West or not, or they've just had a chance to make some money and they understand business better. It's a lot easier than it used to be. Unfortunately, and my last point is, if we think about who's going to be running the country, Russian Federation, in say 20 years, you know, clearly some of the recent activity, whether Ukraine or otherwise, or the remaining levels of corruption or difficulties with property rights that still exist, although you could say they're improving, but some people still feel vulnerable. These are all big issues that need to be addressed, but in no small part, the sanctions have definitely had a large impact on a lot of my friends who have left, whether they were financial services professionals or lawyers or accountants. Many of them have just left because capital markets deals in Russia aren't happening to the same level. And the brain drain that we would have had to Silicon Valley or other places has been complemented by a lot of musky fellows or folks that worked at one of the big four firms or law firms and would have been great partners for us all in Russia over the next 20 to 30 years. So hopefully some of them come back. There's also an education issue in Russia that needs to be addressed. A lot of our contemporaries would have left because their children, they feel their children can get better education in the UK or the US. So that's another huge issue I think Russia needs to compete on. But I think a lot about who will be running Russia in 20 years, and hopefully it's a friend of mine.
And Charlie Ryan is going to be our last speaker. Charlie is another veteran of this whole scene at UFG Asset Management. He spent lots of his time, like most everybody on our panel here, in Moscow as a banker. Again, first with EBRD. And then probably best known to most of us with UFG and with Deutsche Bank, where he was the chief executive officer in Russia.
So I would guess agree with Drew that there is a certain nostalgia about getting this crowd together. We're all a lot older. Some of us have less hair. And we definitely been through quite a ride together. I was thinking in terms of structuring what I would talk about in terms of what I the three phases of my career over this 25 years that I spent most of it living there. The answer to the question of why I went, funny enough, I wrote my college thesis on Soviet foreign policy in Africa, which meant a lot of what I was doing it on was based on Professor Legvold's work. And certainly was at that point thinking that what I might do with my life was somehow get involved in the US side of the Cold War. When I got out of college, it was over. So I had to find something much less interesting to do. So I went to Wall Street. And when the wall came down and I went over to Russia to work for EBRD, I think in some naive sense, I thought I was going to be a capitalist version of John Reed. That I didn't think I would end up in Russia for 16 years. Certainly didn't think I'd be working there today. But I guess wanted a front row seat to observe the return of the market, to return of capitalism and freedom, I guess in the same way that he enjoyed watching the communists show up. The in terms of the work at EBRD, we were pretty optimistic, and I guess perhaps naive in retrospect, but I do think that notwithstanding the general failure of the brand of reform, I think a lot of what we did today is missed, and a lot of the basic building blocks were a function of a collaboration between Russians and institutions like the EBRD. You know, when we showed up, you didn't have accounting firms, you didn't have law firms, and in fact, you know, even today, when you look not only at the pretty wide range of Western firms that are operating in Moscow, even the Russian ones that have now grown up to compete with the Western law firms are staffed by people who got their training at some of these Western legal firms, that many of which were set up with technical assistance and other support that came from this collaboration. I think maybe just a fun anecdote, because I guess we've all been talking a long time. You know, one of the more interesting parts of my time at EBRD was that I spent a lot of time with President Putin when he was deputy mayor of St. Petersburg. And I'm thinking here about how the Russians perceived the Western approach of, you know, we're here with our money to help. And certainly today he's much more blunt, you know, about how he views it. But I remember at the time we were trying to make an investment in Leninitz. It was an old Soviet military industrial firm that Gillette, the razor blade company, wanted to put some money into to produce razor blades. At this point in time, the Russian tax code was not the very reformed version we have today. If we actually paid our taxes on the investment, we would be paying about 140% of our turnover in taxes. So obviously, it didn't make for a very attractive investment. So what we needed to do was to get a waiver, because obviously EBRD, Americans, we had to comply. We had to comply with whatever the rules were. And the only way to make the investment was to get the city of St. Petersburg to give us a waiver. So I worked all night to prepare this, I guess the 1992 version of a PowerPoint. It was basically horizontal, you know, printed out at the Hotel Europe. And I go into Mr. Putin's office to pitch him on why we should get tax waivers. And he, I guess, had just come in from somewhere. He looked tired, didn't seem in a very good mood. And he said, I saw your presentation. And I get it. We don't really need to go through it. I was pretty grumpy because I had worked hard in this and it had not been easy to print it at the Hotel Europe. So I said, really, tell me, what do you get? And then he got really annoyed and he said, I'll tell you what I get. He said, we're new to power. We want to stay in power. Staying in power means providing people with some objective benefit of our period in power, which basically means jobs. Jobs require capital. We don't have any of that just now. Which means, and foreigners do, so that requires foreigners, and foreigners require tax breaks. Ergo, tax breaks means we stay in power. And I said, all right, I guess you do get it. But my point simply is that it was a very pragmatic view of, A, the benefit of foreigners, the benefit of our advice, and how to apply government policy. At the very same time in this part of my life, I was connected to my dear friend, and sorry, sadly, to have passed Boris Fedorov. And this is right around the time when he wrote the letter to Cam Dessau saying, no thanks, don't send us the next tranche of the IMF funding, which clearly made U.S. Treasury apoplectic, did not amuse Prime Minister Chernomyrdin. But there's always been a group of people in Russia that felt at least ambivalent about aid. And I think we've seen that really blossom, particularly in the current period. The second phase of my life over there was as an entrepreneur, where I set up a bank and was advising companies. And here I want to highlight on something that I think is interesting about America and Russia. And I guess the very brief way I've encapsulate what I perceived is that a lot of our business was doing M&A, basically advising foreign investors in their negotiations with Russian firms. And if you do a compare and contrast of a deal we did for Siemens, a deal we did for BP, and a deal we did for International Paper, as you move west, as you get further and further away, people get more nervous, particularly when you got to the US. When we were doing a deal for this German conglomerate, Siemens, I never met the CEO. I met, you know, with the executive vice president for business development, and he sort of let me know when the board approved the deal, and it happened very quickly, and there's really no geopolitical discussion. I remember when we were working for BP, Lord Brown asked me to fly to Los Angeles to present to his board. As I was on my way to the airport, I got a call from his office saying he's realized how ridiculous it is, that he should just do it himself. No need to come to LA. When we were doing our work on behalf of International Paper, we had to go meet with the board two or three times. And generally speaking, at the board meetings, I must admit it felt like it was my deal, not Mr. Faraci's deal. So the funny thing was that the US boards, US decision makers were always a little more cautious and concerned, particularly than the Europeans. And I think that has been an element of the economic relationship, is that generally speaking, the Europeans were much more willing to engage. And for whatever reason, in our country, it's always been a little more of a gamble, a bet. It was somehow distinct and special. I guess the last phase of my life over there, as Drew was alluding to, is being involved in, I guess, doing something like what I did at EBRD, these private equity investments. And there I wanted to talk a little bit about the space that we're allowed to occupy. So, you know, one of the things that I think, and it's connected to sanctions, it's connected to the sorts of entrepreneurs in Russia that really want to talk to a guy like Mike Calvi or Drew Guff or Charlie. And, you know, one thing I can say is that in the same way that I feel that we really did contribute something in setting up some of this basic infrastructure for a market economy, I also would like to say that I think having a relatively small but nonetheless active group of providers of private capital, you know, obviously Barings being the largest, Drew's been doing this about the same length of time, I think has also provided, as both Drew and Mike referred to, a real spur to giving entrepreneurs who wanted an option. Not all the entrepreneurs do. There are some people in Russia, I guess like Peter said, you know, they're very different economic actors. You know, but for all the Russian entrepreneurs that just want to run their business for cash and don't really care about transparency and corporate governance, there is a large number of extremely talented men and women that are willing to jump through the hoops still and to comply, just like we have to as Americans, with the global rules. And whom I hope, nonetheless, even if we're selling their businesses at a discount, like Mike said, they see the benefits of this connection to our way of doing things, which hopefully more and more becomes a Russian way on the business side. But it is sad, you know, it is disappointing and frustrating that a lot of these things we'd hoped would come to pass have not. You know, certainly from the business standpoint, you know, we're going to occupy the space we're allowed. So the sanctions have put another constraint on that. This lack of available capital, Drew mentioned, puts a constraint on that. Funny enough, the hot money is already back in. Apparently about 40% of the OFZs are now owned by US hedge funds. They'll be out once Mrs. Nyabulin starts dropping rates. I just want to, I guess, conclude by simply saying that you know, on the economic side of the relationship, it has inevitably, particularly with the US, does get impacted and is colored by this bad karma and these unmet expectations on both sides. You know, even to the point where today a lot of people don't realize that the sanctions on Russia are nothing like the sanctions on Iran. The truth of the matter is that Europe and Russia in particular are so economically integrated that if you were to apply Iranian-style sanctions, it simply wouldn't work because Germans wouldn't be able to cook their meals on their stoves. A lot of things that are vital to life as we know it in Russia would not be possible without the trade back and forth between the EU and Russia. That being said, there's certainly a perception that the sanctions apply everywhere and to everything. And I think also, as was referred to in terms of jawboning executives into not going to St. Petersburg, jawboning financial institutions into not participating in the Russian Eurobond, there's definitely a pall, you know, over economic activity, even to the point sometimes when some Americans seem to act like we're somehow disloyal to our country by continuing to invest there, which is also a shame because, as I said, we're economic actors. We're trying to invest our clients' money, and we're compliant. We're operating within the space that we are allowed. So I guess on that, I'm very, very happy to be here, and thank you very much, I should have mentioned, to Georgetown and to Angela and Andy for organizing it. It's fun. Yeah.
Thanks, Drew. Thank you, Charlie. So I think, you know, in terms of the takeaway, looking at what we've had on the business side, I mean, everybody talked about, you know, the infrastructure and modernization of the economy, and I think everybody can be proud of the role that's been played in corporate governance and transparency and in basically making, helping Russians make Russia a more modern business environment. In terms of opportunities, everybody's talked about innovative economy being certainly part of the future, and about the necessity of certainly structural reform, better protection of property rights, and other things that are hardy perennials. One thing I'd like to touch on before we open up for questions is a little bit about the economic dialogue, because as somebody who's worked on the political side, one of the things that strikes me right now, and I travel to Russia as much as you all do, I mean, trying to have a reasonable discussion about Ukraine or Crimea is nearly impossible with anybody, no matter where they sit in the political spectrum, because they have some emotional connection to this or because of their political view. And there are lots of constraints on those discussions. If you flip to the economic side, it's completely different. The debate in Russia about where to go with the economy is pretty open. People are extremely critical of the government and of their counterparts. They're pretty willing to talk to all of us about all of these things. And at the same time, through this very, very difficult period, where particularly the governments shut down their dialogue, we kind of all continued, not only on a personal basis, but I would say the U.S.-Russia Business Council, we probably have paradoxically better ties with Yelovaya Rossiya, the Business Russia, with the Russian Association of Industrials and Entrepreneurs. In fact, I think there has been a feeling on the business side that we need to spend more time together and try to do some things together on not only on dialogue and talking about private-public partnerships, but what we do about business education, all of these issues to sort of try to add some modest ballast to the relationship while the political relationship is so difficult. But I don't know, I'd be interested in what you all think about business dialogue and, you know, where we go from here in terms of trying to connect what we're all doing to the political discussion that's taking place in the other panels.
Well, I'll just say a few words. I mean, the fact that we're all here is a great start. Bill Courtney has been running the
yes.
the Russia Rand Business Elite Group. It started really with the early days under Jeremy Azrael, getting getting the business people of the day. The oligarchs, together with European and U.S. CEOs, and it's continued on. It says something about the power of relationships. You know, we're those of us who, you know, do business here and also in emerging markets. There are the reliance on relationships in emerging market investing is so much greater than in the U.S. We have institutions, accepted norms, and relationships are just much more important in terms of investing in Russia. I remember having dinner with Don Kendall a few years ago, and he said that when he turned 90, President Putin called him on his birthday to wish him happy birthday. Now, I can't imagine any U.S. president calling a retired CEO of an international company that invested in the United States to wish him a happy birthday on his 90th birthday. It just is sort of unheard of. But Don Kendall's a major figure. But, you know, Charlie talked about relationships. Peter talked about relationships. They are so important, and they tend to be much stronger between, you know, when you have a counterparty. You're relying a little bit less on good law. You're relying a little bit less on good court systems. And so the power of those relationships are extremely strong. And I'm happy to say the quality of those relationships are better, I have seen, than in a lot of other emerging market investing. And that's if you were to compare it to China or India, for example, one of the most corrupt places on earth that people just don't realize. The power of relationships with Russian counterparts is really important. So it's been one of the things that's remained through all the these bad times. I wish there was kind of more dynamism in getting business people together, but there have been some very good attempts at it. And just the fact that Angela and Andy have invited us here to be here today is just another good sign of it. I mean, I think, Dan, when you go around the table at the U.S.-Russia Business Council and talk about how are companies doing in Russia, the answer is usually, except you know for recent issues, pretty well. My profit margins are good, and when we have problems, the Russian government is often there to step in and help. That's been our experience too.
Thanks. Fyodor, and I'm particularly interested in your views because IMAMO and the Atlantic Council, sort of strange bedfellows, have certainly worked together looking ahead on strategic issues together.
Yeah, we have issued recently a common strategic forecast till 2035, which is called Global System on the Brink. But I want to focus on domestic political effects, which sanctions and the U.S. Policy towards Russia after Crimea caused. The paradox is that on the one hand, sanctions caused, which were aimed initially from the beginning to have influence on so-called inner circle of Vladimir Putin, but not to hurt the whole economy. They have the opposite effect. They influenced on the economy, they influenced on private enterprise, but probably not on the inner circle so strongly as they were aimed to. But paradox is that on the one hand, in a Russian economic, domestic political discussion on economy, it has become, sanctions have become a reason for some voices for, import substitution, for counter-sanctions, for all these negative, policies, not, market-based, aimed by political motivation and, targeted to have a response for Western attitudes. But on the other hand, Western sanctions had a very positive effect because together with, the decrease of oil prices, they made our government think about structural reforms, about stronger institutions, about more responsible, monetary policy. And I want to emphasize that during all this period, Russian the monetary policy of Russian Central Bank was absolutely liberal and very conservative in terms of measures they used. In terms of regulation of market, in terms of usage of financial and market and non-market instruments, it stimulated very development of very liberal approach. And I think that Vladimir Putin himself was not against of it. He supported this course. Now he supports a dialogue, a discussion between different group of economists in our country. And everybody here know that some preparations of ideas, of new ideas for the new government after the elections of 2018 are taking place in Moscow. And a lot of think tanks are involved in this process. But what I think will be more significant than even sanction relief, the more significant could be the policy, which could be more driven by economic interests, more driven by motivation of private enterprise, of course, including private enterprise working in Russia, foreign private enterprise. But, you know, for many reasons, during all this period of, you know, sanctions, exchange of sanctions, I think Russian government was trying to play the game. I'm not trying to advocate them, but to, trying to play the game which can be more based on the logic of market economy and more based on the logic of economic interdependence than Western governments. That's the paradox.
I certainly hope you're right.
I believe I'm right.
I mean, we've seen the balance. I think everybody in the international business community has been very impressed with what the central bank's done. In terms of going to you know, a full float of the ruble, avoiding capital controls. But at the same time, many of our companies, their biggest concern have been, as you rightly identified, the protectionist measures on import substitution, localization, more restrictions on government procurement. Because I think, you know, if you ask if you were going to sum out what's wrong with the Russian economy in one word, it's lack of competition. And the concern is that this protectionist wave, which we also have here in the United States.
Dan, mostly these protectionist measures were caused by external influence. Mostly they were motivated with sanctions. That was the response. This is the paradox.
I mean, funny enough, there's an interesting little slice of this, which is if you think that, you know, given the rapid process of change and the developments, there were some things the Russians didn't build that most countries have. Like, I think one of the more interesting moments during the post-Ukraine sort of political crisis was the discovery that the domestic payment system was run by Visa. You know, most countries have their own payment system, and so it could be interpreted as an act of economic nationalism or, you know, restrictive, but nonetheless, probably a good idea to have your own domestic payment system, you know, and the fact that it could then be turned off by a, you know, someone and but I'm just saying, if most countries do. I think the other funny one was the discovery that a huge proportion of Russian government data was stored on AWS servers in Washington State. Again, it's a perfectly rational economic choice because it's a very cheap and reliable provider. But I can also understand why it might not be the place where you, from a national security standpoint, you wanted all of your ministry's documents.
Yeah, I think all of us spend a lot of time, you know, explaining to Russians what's the American view and explaining to Americans what's the Russian view. But there's no doubt in my mind that the sanctions have had an effect to basically weaken the people who are the most pro-American and kind of, you know, liberal in their thinking in the classic sense, and strengthen kind of, you know, hardliners and nationalists. But I don't know what makes me more depressed to listen to the, you know, Russian TV or to listen to what is sometimes said in the U.S. Congress. You know, both using selective facts and not alternative facts, but selective facts where they
fake news.
They just choose to focus on certain facts and ignore the others on both sides, and it's. You know, it's very unbalanced and depressing. So,
let's try to open up for questions here, and we'll let we all know who Andy is, but if you could please state your name and your affiliation when you ask your question, please.
Well, Mike, I, as a basketball player, well, watch basketball. That's my recommendation. That's my answer.
What's the question?
First, the question would be getting depressed watching.
All right, okay.
Watching
what is
Russian
there to watch
news
on TV?
And American news. First of all, we're delighted. Angela and I are very happy to give you the opportunity to have a reunion here and share this nostalgic feeling, and hope we can do it more often. Drew, I was a little bit amused when you mentioned the company In Vitro, because it reminded me of the Gaishniki. And the Gaishniki, the road police, when they pull you over, always threatening to send you to the Vrach, you know, with the big needle. lithication together they're using in vitro?
Yeah, our needles are clean. Don't worry about it.
I don't doubt that. My question, and Mike started to get to it at this with his last comment. Now we're in the 3 years of sanctions and about 2.5 years of sectoral sanctions. What is the observation of decisions that the Russian companies are making, and sometimes more strategic decisions they're making that they may not have made in a non-sanctions environment? I understand some of the decisions, or at least about our investments, are driven by concerns about the investment environment and the lower oil price. But the decisions that you see that companies are making that in some ways are maybe not in their best interests if they had this alternative, and maybe not in our best interests either.
I can do one quick one.
Peter?
Sure. So about 2 years ago, or a year and a half ago, TMK had a euro bond that was going to be coming due soon, and they were going to have to come up with several hundred million dollars within a year or two to pay it back. And it was clear to me that at some point, I guess it was roughly a year after Ukraine, that the senior management and the owner effectively had come to the view that they really shouldn't expect to be able to finance themselves at all in international capital markets for the foreseeable future. So they went to some of the Russian banks, raised money at a much higher rate in rubles, as you would expect, a much higher rate, and did a tender offer for a euro bond that wasn't due for another year, just in order to reduce that refinancing risk. And we had a long debate about it, and the optimists on the board thought that we might be able to do better if we just waited a little bit, but they were very clear that they'd received, whether it was guidance from the very top in Russia or just didn't want to take the risk of having to refinance in a year if things hadn't gotten better. And I thought that was a pity, because it definitely cost the company $10 to $15 million of net profit, the higher financing cost. But they chose to do it just to reduce that risk. So
all companies have hunkered down and have cut costs, have made the assumption they can't get financing or they can't sell themselves or can't go public for the foreseeable future. That's been one big effect. And the other big effect on sanctions, which is the unfortunate boomerang negative effect, is that the companies that need financing the most were the ones most hurt by the sanctions. The big state companies, they can go to the well capitalized big banks and state banks. Small and medium sized enterprises got hit the worst and the hardest by the sanctions, and we see it across our portfolios and across the economy.
And most of the companies that we own, we're the kind of companies that are not directly affected by sanctions. And I think actually the oil price drop has had a much bigger effect on Russian business of the kind we own, because it caused the currency to go down with it. So if you're a foreign investor measuring your investments in dollars, that's just an immediate and unavoidable hit. But it also wreaked havoc in the banking system with the Russian banks raising their interest rates very high, and it's caused a huge slowdown in lending and focus on deleveraging. So the sanctions have played a part to that, but I think it's like 70-30 or 80-20 and skewed towards the oil price having a bigger impact on company decisions. With the ruble falling, also the focused on rubleization of your thinking and sources of supply, buying stuff locally, not because the government is telling you to, but because everything that's sourced locally is now 2 times cheaper than whatever you could buy abroad.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Stefan Meister from the German Council on Foreign Relations. You mentioned rightly the big success story of digital economy. I think this was one of the most dynamic or is the most dynamic industries in Russia, private sector with startups, with big companies. That always amazed me. At the same time, we observe at the moment growing pressure, especially on the digital economy, giving the state more information. That's maybe also a trend we observe in other countries, but also a shift from the Russian model of open internet to the Chinese model of a closed internet, I think, which is a very negative development. Do you see a trend there? And what signals does it send to you as American business?
Yeah, I... one of the investments that Mike and I have in common is this investment in Yandex. I'm still on the board of Yandex, which is a company that's sort of on the front line of this whole discussion. And I think one thing that is important to keep in context is that not only does Russia not have the great firewall like China does, but it also hasn't kicked out Google. In other words, I think one of the things that people forget is how liberal Russia is in some ways. I mean, like John Stuart Mill, obviously. But the you know, I mean, like, for example, yogurt is not a strategic good in Russia. Apparently it is in France. You know, there's a lot of places where the Russians are happy to have private capital, even foreign capital. I think on the question of data security, you know, certainly it's putting a big burden on a lot of global digital players who are having to think about how they would adapt their business to then have to keep the data inside Russia. On the other hand, you know, it's really not just a Russian problem, it's really a European issue, which is that most of the internet traffic in Europe is run on American companies' sites. It just is a fact that, you know, Yandex is the largest node in Europe because it's the one large internet company in Europe. And certainly those national security concerns, et cetera, are a big worry. But up till now, and I guess knock on wood, you know, the internet in Russia is quite free, and certainly more free than it is in some countries in Asia. And at this point, notwithstanding the restrictions on mass media, any Russian who wants to at any time can look at just about anything on the internet.
Yeah, there was a big debate about 10 years ago when the Russian government was seriously considering, you know, what to do with the internet and whether there should be more, you know, great firewall or something else like that. And to their credit, they decided that it's not something that can be controlled that way and that Russia would be better off with an open internet. And so that has succeeded. So the companies like Yandex that are winning are doing it despite fierce competition from Google. And it's because Russian users view it as a better resource.
Yes, sir.
Good afternoon. I'm Nick Wondra from the U.S. Department of Energy. And I want to ask about a term that recurred in this discussion a couple of times, and that is structural reform. First, as Western businessmen, what do you mean specifically when you say structural reform? And secondly, when a Russian government counterpart hears that term, what do you think they think that means?
I have an economist.
You want me to start?
Sure.
Whoever. First of all, We need to look at the picture from the beginning. You know, I'm a historian by my background. And from the beginning, Russia didn't have any normal market institutions in 1991. It has created everything from the beginning. Banking system, insurance system, model of regulation, financial market, everything. You know, of course, the process is taking a lot of time. The process is encountering a lot of domestic, political, social, and other troubles. But Russia is still keeping very liberal model of taxes. And that's the paradox. Even in times of crisis, even in times when social obligations are growing, Russia is trying to catch up, Western, not European, but American approach towards taxation. Of course, a lot of people from private enterprise will say that there are a lot of covered taxes. There are a lot of taxes which are working, indirectly. But anyway, taxation system is rather liberal. We do not have a serious, strong court system, and it's one of our biggest problems. We do not have, probably Mike mentioned it, a real insurance market. Yeah, and our banking sector is developing. But look what a Russian government has done to protect the banking system during last 3 years. A lot of, toxic banks which had toxic assets, they were closed and they went through sanation. So our government is doing something, maybe probably not in the appropriate speed. And it always encounters, you know, domestic political pressure from groups of political elite and society which are not interested in, you know, development of normal market economy and integration into, you know, global economy, because there are nationalists. It's obvious. It's obvious for any developing country. There are people who prefer absolutely non-market vision of economy. But I think that it is also a generation problem. Because my generation is the first one which grew up, I'm 37, during post-Soviet period, and never seen a socialist, you know, centralized non-market economy. And my generation, people of my age and a little bit older, a little bit younger, coming into power, and most of them are very rational, pragmatic technocrats.
So when I think of structural reform, just me personally, since you asked the panelists too, I think of simplification and modernization of regulations across sectors. I think of reduction in state involvement in the different sectors of the economy. I think of strengthening of the court system.
Yeah. Those and pension reform. I'd add pension reform to that.
Okay. Strengthening of the court system can't be a structural reform. That's a long-term process. It's going to take a long time.
Yeah. Bill?
Yes, Bill Courtney, RAND Corporation. About a year ago, Russia tried to float a sovereign bond in New York. It was not sanctioned, but Treasury and State called New York banks to discourage them to do that. So that's part of the gray zone around sanction. How helpful would it be for investors if that gray zone were reduced, if you will? For example, one imagines that the Trump administration might not do what the Obama administration did last year.
Yep, I agree. I think that, that gray zone, the halo effect of sanctions, probably will will probably just disappear, and that may be a first sign of some pickup for or a first, you know, signal to foreign investors that they can follow the actual language, the technical actual four corners of the document language of sanctions, which allows for, you know, a lot of investment in Russia. It's really only certain sectors, certain areas of the economy that are under sanction. But I agree.
I think there's an interesting sort of nuance here, which is that historically, because investors that are in Russia, who have operated there and had the relationships and the experience, tend to continue investing. I think part of the problem with the overall is even if you actually took the time to read the sanctions like Drew's suggesting, you'd find that they're relatively narrow and specific. But I think one thing that is currently very much affected by the gray zone is, and irrespective of some change, is new entrants are not coming.
Mm-hmm.
You know, new investors, new strategics.
Right. I fully agree. Boards of directors that might have been open to green lighting a Russian investment today, it's, you know, the question that will be asked is why? It could be too difficult. Why should we do it? Why should we undertake it? I agree.
Absolutely. Dina, for the last question. Are you?
One more.
Okay. Harley? Yeah.
Thank you. Harley Balzer, recently retired from Georgetown. I guess my own experience in the last 25 years was on three very different kinds of boards. The first one was Board of Directors for Soros' International Science Foundation. We put $300 million into supporting scientists, education, and the internet. Soros is, of course, now a Russian equivalent of a four-letter word. The second was a program that Diana and Andy both had a lot to do with, the Basic Research Higher Education Program that set up 20-some centers of research and education in Russia. Putin bragged about them in 2014 in one of his election documents, but they're now no longer being funded. And the third one is the Board of Trustees of the European University in St. Petersburg, the only Russian institution that's actually gotten its graduates hired by Ivy League universities to teach. And it is now on the chopping block. The best info we have on that is that even though the excuse is we don't have a gymnasium for 250 graduate students, the real problem is that Dmitry Medvedev is part of a group that has invested in renovating the building next door, complete with luxury elevators to get your car up to your apartment, and they want our palace too. I don't expect the top levels of the Russian government to do much to support human capital. You folks know a lot of the Russian business people, and I'd love to hear whether you're seeing signs of something creative from them to try to do something about corporate governance, and especially about investing in education and science. Thanks.
Well, we hire a lot of people from Moscow University, especially FizTech and Высшая школа экономики and places like that, and they're outstanding, and highly motivated, hungry, super well-educated. I think there's an issue with brain drain for the people who are in their 40s who made a lot of money 20 years ago, 10 years ago, and they can't make money as easily in Russia today. So it takes a lot harder work, and it's a tougher slog. And so people like that, a lot of them are making the kind of calculation that, it's not worth it. But for the younger people in their 20s and 30s, we still see lots of young, motivated people, lots of entrepreneurs and things like that. So, unfortunately, I think as a result of the geopolitical environment, there's a lot of good and well-intended, Western initiatives, including from NGOs and from philanthropic activities that are being canceled. And that's obviously very self-damaging for Russia. But it's not, you have to put it in the, you have to put it in. Well, for sure, we see it with, the universities.
I think there's two layers here. One is that you have private actors, like Mike's firm, mine, et cetera, that are hiring kids. Yandex has a school of data that's their attempt to create more data scientists. So Andre Kartunov is familiar with the work of the U.S.-Russia Foundation that had this Eureka program where we were pairing American universities who are strong in science and technology with Russian universities to create tech transfer offices and to build sort of an infrastructure for providing Russian scientists with a path towards getting their intellectual property commercialized. But I will agree that a lot of these initiatives now are anything that was involved collaboration and particularly involved, funding from, questionable foreign organizations is it's not very popular and it can get you in trouble. So I think this private sector action will continue, but I do think a lot of these government-sponsored forms of collaboration and support for the time being, unfortunately, are not going to work.
Let me add a couple.
Private companies will pick up some slack, but I wouldn't overstate it. We have two companies that in former Soviet Union, so in Russia and former CIS countries, employ about 10,000 computer programmers. But that's a drop in the bucket. The real business of education has got to be funded by the government, and the government is not putting the money into it. The budget's not there for it. I mean, what we as private investors can do and what Russian companies can do is barely scratches the surface of basically having a better education system and more money available for the university system and primary education. So, it's a matter of national priority, I think. And, the Russian government, so for foreign investors, anybody who invests in Russian government bonds, you feel safe because, it's run with a tight fist, not looking to do a lot of deficit spending, and the priorities of education get balanced off against security, defense spending, and a lot of other things that take up budget rubles. So I think it's more of an internal will question or a question of internal priorities for the government to decide where it wants to spend its money.
There are some private sector initiatives, though. I mean, German Greff at Sparebank has a fabulous university for the professional development of his staff, which I think is certainly world-class. And a lot of private sector U.S. CEOs and other C-suite people have spoken there. We've tried to help Yale University and the Moscow School of Management at Skolkovo try to establish a partnership with private sector support. These are small initiatives, but they do exist.
I could speak briefly on TMK and Rosneft. I know TMK will prioritize what they're doing in Skolkovo and also in Yekaterinburg, where Mr. Pupiansky is from, and they have substantial industrial production. And Rosneft would also be supportive of Skolkovo and very supportive of the Energy Institute, Kupkina. So fairly specific to their businesses.
So we promise that we try to end on time and help Andy and Angela get back on schedule here. So thank you all very much. Thanks to our panelists. Thank you, Fyodor. Thank you, our business group.